Hi, my name is Ben Hong, and I'm a staff developer experience engineer, and I'm on the Vue core team. The reason I created this course is because the Vue ecosystem has matured a lot, and best practices and techniques have emerged, which I want to share with you to build great Vue apps. In this course, I'll be covering a deeper dive on component techniques and patterns, and helping you gain a solid understanding on creating composables with Composition API, enhancements to routing, and how to handle state management at scale. Go out and build amazing Vue apps.
Next thing we want to talk about is transparent components. And so this is where this is going to become actually rather critical. We're going to take a look at our code base. And one of the things you'll notice here is that if you take a look at, say, like the input field, this is another common one where, let's face it, forms are about like, what, 95% of our bread and butter as web developers. And so it would make sense for us to basically take this form control that we have here, where we have a typical task input of text, and then basically wrap it in a component that can then be reused, right? Because then our styles and stuff can propagate, and we don't have to deal with all this all the time. So your first instinct when you're thinking of this is like, all right, cool, we're going to go ahead, let's create a base text input. That's what we're going to do. All right. So we'll take this bit here, this whole title, and we're going to go ahead, and so I'm going to go ahead and queue up the single file component. Did not install SAS, so that won't be applicable. And we'll drop it in here. OK, first thing first. So let's go ahead and let's ignore this. Let's not worry about the V model for now. This is good. We've got a placeholder. We have a disabled OK setting and whether it's required or not. OK, so typically when we're designing components, your first instinct might be to define props for every single one of these. But this is that would be a lot, right? Because then you're basically just kind of recreating the DOM API. And so what we really need is to think about what we want to do as far as like, OK, we want to configure specific things that we're going to use within this base text input. So let's start with some of the obvious ones. So the first one is we're going to want to always give it a label. So that would be type, string, oh, wait, yeah, I did that right. Required, true. And so we know that here, for example, we can say, OK, the label will go here. And then here we have this thing where we also need to pair the for attribute with the ID. So usually I find this actually just easier to just call it ID. And then this way we'll just use it to populate both. So then type string, require true. And then we can just populate here and here. OK, so that's good. Whether it's disabled or not, that is something that you would think that you want to define, but honestly, this is actually something we would want to be able to just pass through because this is part of the native input. And so not something you necessarily want to configure. And whether it's required or not, that you also think, yeah, that should be something that should just be passed through as well. And so then you're also probably thinking, okay, well then, yeah, actually, in fact, what I really want is for most of the attributes that Vue passes to go to this input element. Because really, this is the whole purpose of us creating this reusable piece, right? The label is really not what's being customized. Neither is this form control that we're wrapping around. And so the question is, how do we do that? And so using what we just learned about, what we could do, you're probably thinking, is, well, couldn't we do this vbind equals, and then if you didn't know this, we have this thing called $adders, which stands for attributes. And so what Vue does essentially is take all the attributes that you pass this custom component and then sends it to whatever element that you wanted to, like basically you're assigning it to. So when you do this, let's go ahead and actually bring this up. So what I'm going to do, how do I want to do this? Okay. We're going to go ahead and we're going to create a quick view real quick. I'm going to call this sandbox page.view. And this page is just going to serve as like something separate from the application code. And that way we can just basically queue it up and see different demos without interrupting the rest of it. So I'm going to go ahead and update that real quick. I will drop this all the way here on the bottom. So this will be sandbox. And then this will be the sandbox page. OK, see the arcs to the right. So we open this up. OK, yep, it's empty right now, so that makes sense. Let me go ahead and fire that up. Sandbox page. There we go. All right, we see our sandbox page. All right, so what I'm going to want to do now is let's go ahead and import that base text input that we just created. So base text input is created, and then we're going to go ahead and bring it on. And we're going to do, we're going to add a placeholder, and we're going to call it my test placeholder. And then, oh, yes, partial holder is not assignable. That's fine. OK, so we save that. And then you'll see, here we go. Here's my text being bound. And what you notice here is that this placeholder is being passed correctly accordingly into the input in this particular case. But something that should be kept in mind, though, is that especially when you have different routes, so some, like, it's kind of funny that it's working in this particular case. But what I wanted to demo is the fact that you do sometimes find that, especially with the single root nodes, what Vue typically does, again, it's kind of interesting the behavior is happening here, is that it'll actually send your attributes to the root node. Because that's what Vue knows, right? Whereas if you think about it another way, if we had multiple nodes here, Vue has a hard time determining where to send something to. And so typically what we want to do is when we're binding the adders, is you have to do something called basically to disable the inherit attributes. And so there's this macro inside of the script setup for Vue that's called define options. And so for those who come from the Vue 2 days, you might recognize it as basically that it would look like this instead. And you would say inherit attributes false. So we basically created a macro to make this easier to do so that you didn't have to have a script block and a script setup block. And so this whole thing can then be put inside of here, and just like that.
How do you know you want to use a composable versus a util method?
Oh, I love it. You read my mind. Let's move on to this. Composable versus utilities. So that's exactly it. So I think most people, they see this and they're like, cool, I'm just going to cram everything in composables, right? Because it's, you know, it's kind of easy. It works. I mean, let's be honest, it does work. Nothing wrong with that. However, in discussion of, you know, in case for those who are newer to the industry, what's actually really common in a lot of enterprise code bases too is this either utils, oh wait, whoops, wrong folder. There's usually some sort of utils folder or utilities. And so when differentiating between the two, I would say the key thing here is that composables, if you think about it, composables is a term originated from the fact that it's the Vue composition API, meaning that it's using Vue things. And so oftentimes this means it's regarding some sort of stateful UI, whether it's using reactive data with like REST, reactives, or lifecycle methods. On the other hand, utilities are really like when you think of Lodash, when you think of Moment.js. These are things that have like generic purpose and really in some ways are kind of more that pure function mentality, right? They're there for one specific thing, whether it's like two uppercase, whatever, you choose your pick. Those are usually what I consider more of the utilities, is that they really have nothing to do with Vue. And so in this regard, you might say, well, Forma's task status label doesn't technically have any Vue things on it. But what we could say with confidence, though, is that this particular bit of, like, let's call it a search algorithm, is specific to tasks, right? And so unless we could prove that, like, this particular status label is going to be genericized, maybe, to a bunch of other status labels, again, let's just assume for now that this particular logic is only associated with tasks. So one could then make the case that it really probably does belong more so in the composables. And I'll give you a hint. Part of the reason I say this, too, is that we mentioned that status is a string here. But one of the things that's like a hint to what's coming is that status is not necessarily just a plain value. And so we'll talk more about that later. This has to do with composable design. And so here, we can see here, there is, like, there in this regard, right, we have a task list that's being dropped down. There's a lot of filtering happening. So now there's even the question of business logic, right? Because composables doesn't necessarily equate to business logic, nor does it necessarily equate to utilities. And so David gave a great talk yesterday and was talking about this. And I do think when you're thinking about these three kind of categories, what a lot of times people do, especially with composables, is they kind of stuff everything together because it feels like the easiest thing to do, right? But the problem is you end up with this kind of tight coupling when it comes to testing. Because imagine if you want to test your business logic, but it's tied to the fact that you have to navigate to a page and then click a button and then do things. That doesn't really make sense. That's, your business logic really should have nothing to do with what's on the web page, right? There should be multiple ways to execute payment functions, authentication, whatever unique value proposition your business offers. That to me is like what like David mentioned is like sort of like your pure functions, right? You should be able to test those in a vacuum and they should work every time, regardless of what the UI is, right? Utilities, I would say that what separates logic from utilities is that utilities aren't related to your business, like core business, right? You could replace them with kind of any generic thing, but like logic, because that's what some people do. They do have a separate folder for logic. And then that is their pure functions that resolve basically targeted to their business stuff. One of the struggles with testing is that you try to test everything. But as we know, as software developers, sometimes you just don't have the resources to do so. You might only, and especially if your tests take a really long time, you want to test your core functionality. Separating out your business logic into like a specific folder makes it easy to go, you know what, we're going to trust that the utilities are working and the composables are fine, but we must test the business logic every time. Because my mentor would say, there are only two tests any company ever needs. Can the user log in? And can they pay us? Everything else is optional, right? As far as some best practice items. So I mentioned before about the whole global stores, namespace stores things. One of the things that I think, this is an artifact, so I think for most of you, this is at least here, this is not applicable. But like Eduardo in his course talks about this a lot, in his, is that some clients, they got so used to just putting everything in a single state, like in a single store, because it was incredibly convenient, right? I'll put my, I need auth everywhere. Might as well just put it in the store, in global store. I should track whether or not the cookies are tracked. That's global store. And so his whole thing, and which I've seen as well, is that don't be afraid to just create like a bunch of small stores. Like just, because it doesn't cost you anything, and arguably it makes it easier because you've already modularized these single sources of truth. This is my auth store, this is my cookie store, this is my, you know, whatever you want to call it. And then as we saw earlier, actually, I think the magic keys plus the theme is an example of like, it's so easy to put them together. If you're like, oh, there's this, like, let's call it on like, you know, the settings page where like the auth and the cookies need to live together. Like, cool, just like grab them, throw them in, like no problem. And so if we think, as long as we think more like that about these stores being single sources of truth, because the moment, what's scary is when you have, what a lot of people end up trying to do is they get caught up in storing like auth in multiple places, right? Because they're like, oh, well, I'm updating auth here, and then here is where auth will get updated. So I keep like, and so if they incorrectly cache them and keep them separate source of truth, this is where our issues come in, right? Ultimately, right? That's like a lot of our bugs. And so ensuring that your stores are small helps to ensure that they are a single source of truth, which means ultimately you'll be less bugs over time. And so we've talked about this on different occasions now, but composing stores with other stores is a thing. So you saw there was a time entry store, there's a task store. Our exercise later will be to create a week store. So you all can basically, you're gonna convert your composable into like a Pinia store and just basically see how you feel about that. And then what's nice is that using other stores within stores is as simple as you would expect, right? So in the event in my time entry store, I want to use, let's say for whatever reason, I want to collaborate this entry count with my total number of tasks. I could just go import use task store. And then here I would just say, yes, const task store equals use task store. And then I could say, const combine count is computed, and it's going to return entry count dot value plus task store dot task count. And like just like that, you've taken two stores that are seemingly unrelated, and then because you've found the logic for it, boom, you've combined them. It pulls the piece you need. It works. And so that was part of Eduardo's thing, is trying to get people to understand that, unlike before, it is actually very easy to kind of rip apart stores, piece them together, and then like mishmash them in other places as well. And if you keep doing that, you'll find yourself with, hopefully some pretty elegantly crafted state management solutions for you and your team.